Good morning.
Good to see everybody this morning, and always good to be in the Lord's house as we give our thanks and praise to God for this day and every day. I'd like to invite all the children forward at this time for a children's message. Let us rise. We begin our worship together with confession and forgiveness. We begin this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done, things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As I call an ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us sing together our gathering song, Morning Has Broken, number 556.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God, you are the source of life and the ground of our being. By the power of your Spirit, bring healing to this wounded world and rise us to new life in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Congregation may be seated for the reading.
Our first reading this morning comes to us from Hosea chapter 5. I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face. In their distress, they will beg my favor. Come, let us return to the Lord, for it is he who is torn, and he will heal us. He has struck down, and he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise up, that we may live before him. Let us know, let us press on to know the Lord. His appearing is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us like the showers, like the spring rains that water the earth. What shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, O Judah? Your love is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Therefore I have hewn them by the prophets. I have killed them by the words of my mouth. And my judgment goes forth as the light. For I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read our psalm this morning in unison. It comes from a portion of Psalm 70. Listen, my people, and I will speak. Israel will bear witness against you, for I am God, your God. I do not accuse you because of your sacrifices. Your burnt offerings are always before me. I will not accept a calf from your stalls, nor goats from your pens, for all the wild animals of the forest are mine, the cattle on a thousand hills. I know every bird of the mountains, and the creatures of the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the whole world is mine and all that is in it. Do you think I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall honor me. Our second reading this morning is from Romans chapter 4. The promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, "So numerous shall your descendants be." He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. In other words, it was reckoned to him, were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who is handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th chapter. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hands on her and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. Then suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhage for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned and seeing her said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players in the crowd making commotion, he said, "Go away, for the girl's not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout that district. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. Amen. I guess I'm getting older because I do a lot of thinking about the different parts of our lives. And it has felt to me lately that I haven't lived just one life, but really many different lives, or at least different parts of my life. And the reason is because in different parts of our lives, we have certain things, people, and places that often change over time. If you were here in last week's sermon, I talked about touchstones of our lives, about people, places, and things that stay the same and ground us. But the other side of that, there's lots of things in our lives that we leave behind. We might move to different places in our lives. I've lived in Maine, Boston, Allentown, Pennsylvania, Philadelphia, New York, and of course, New Hampshire. I even lived in San Francisco, California for 3 days. Long enough to live in California, just to let you know. I've had friendships that have come and gone. I've had different jobs. I've worked at Burger King, Dunkin' Donuts, Market Basket, Outback Steakhouse, Brantley's Pizza Pasta Grill, place called the Chase Home, City Year, and of course, being a pastor. Just as an example, I was thinking this week of a friend of mine from high school. I'll call him Chris. And Chris and I were really best friends since we were in sixth grade. And in high school, we became even closer to the point where we really did everything together. Pretty much from the morning until evening, Chris and I were together. And we did everything together, including getting in a lot of trouble. And my parents actually didn't really like Chris, mainly because when I was around him, I usually got in some kind of trouble. And I want to say that all of that was my fault. I chose those things willingly and openly. I wasn't peer pressure. I did them because I wanted to do them. I can't blame Chris for that. But when I was a junior in high school, I realized, and it became obvious to me, that Chris and I really couldn't become friends anymore, that we really had to go our separate ways, that my path in life was not the path that Chris wanted to go down. And it was incredibly hurtful and painful and difficult, but it also had to happen. If I had stayed friends with Chris, I am sure I would not be here today, and I'm doubly sure I would never have become a pastor. God was calling me to something else. Today we hear the brief story of Jesus calling Matthew away from his tax booth into a life of following Jesus. And Matthew instantly agrees to that call. Now we could talk a lot about the reasons for Matthew to leave his lucrative tax collecting job to follow some weird preacher who really had nothing to offer him. But what I really want us to think about together this morning is, how does Jesus' call to Matthew similar to the same call that you and I are called to? And how that call is never easy. How it demands of us that we leave things behind in order to step into the new world that Jesus invites us to. And that word invite is actually problematic, because I was reading this week about how in the Greek, Jesus doesn't invite Matthew, he commands him. It's the imperative in the Greek. A command, a call to something immediate and important. Follow me. And for me, that's problematic because I always like to read the text like Jesus is inviting us. But Matthew was not invited. He was commanded. And I was trying to think this week, what's the good part of that? What's the good part of being commanded to do it in our lives? And I think the good thing is that in order to follow Jesus, we have to leave something behind. If we're not commanded to do it, we probably won't leave those things behind. And that's not easy. And I was actually discussing this with a colleague this week over lunch, that we sometimes as pastors make the mistake of trying to make it too easy for people. I want this to be easy for all of you. I really do. I want you to know how much God loves you in Christ and helps you love others and care for them. It seems really simple, and there's truth in that statement, but that's not the full truth. If we accept God's grace and love, there are demands that are placed upon our lives, and those demands mean we're going to have to leave some things behind in our lives. Those demands means we're going to have to leave the tax booth. We might have to leave behind a friend or two. We might have to make changes and leave and go to another city. We might have to lose our prejudices, our preconceived notions of the world. And it might make us uncomfortable at times. It might be sad and hurtful and painful. But what Jesus invites us into and commands us, I suppose, is actually way better. It's way better than what we have. And I'm willing to bet that if you had asked Matthew at the end of his time with Jesus if it was worth it, he would have said yes. Even with all the uncertainty, even with all that serving of others and giving up your life, even with the hurt and pain that came on Good Friday, Matthew would tell you that the experience of community, of inclusion, of love, opened him up to something way more powerful and exciting. In his time with Jesus, he learns the truth of what Jesus teaches this morning, that I desire mercy and not sacrifice. A quote that comes from our first reading from the prophet Hosea, and is at the heart of the gospel. It's at the heart of the Bible. It's at the heart of the vision that God wants us to see in this world and the vision of what it means to be his disciple. It is what we are called to learn as we follow Jesus. And it is so much easier, I think, just to do the things that good Christians are supposed to do. You know, go to church, tithe, pray, maybe serve on a committee, follow the rules. But those are not the things that God really wants from us. God wants so much more. God wants us to forgive, to welcome the stranger, to love those in the world who are unlovable, to eat with sinners and outcasts. God wants us to leave behind all the things that hold us back from truly loving and caring about other people. Sure, Matthew could have had a good life being a tax collector, right? He could have had a nice house and a nice family. Tax collectors made a lot of money, could have been rich. Maybe he would have been looked down upon by his neighbors, but who really cares? He got a good life. What does that matter? Jesus came and showed him a new way, called him from that booth into a wider world. And Jesus does the same for all of us. But don't misunderstand, friends. It will cost us something. We'll have to leave something behind. It will be hurtful and painful at times, just as my ending that important friendship was hurtful at that time in my life. But I was being called to something else. This is the other thing about the command Matthew received. He could have said no. He could have declined. But I believe there's something so powerful about that command that Jesus compels us to actually say yes. There's something in that life that we are called to that, even though it isn't easy and might hurt, makes us want to say yes. Because Matthew knew somewhere in himself that he wanted what Jesus was offering. And I believe we all do. We all know on some level that we need the mercy that God provides. That we have had enough in our lives of sacrificing ourselves on the altar of not good enough. The past 2 days I've been at the Synod Assembly, and this is exactly what we were talking about. How Christ's call means we have to leave things behind. At the Assembly, we spent a good portion of our time talking about being anti-racism. And how that conversation demands of us opening up ourselves, giving up what we think is right and good and honorable, instead listening to our neighbors and the pain that they have experienced. Very hard to do, friends. But that's the kind of thing that God calls us to do. We talked about at the Assembly how congregations that are closing, merging, are having to find another way to be the church, and how that means for them giving up things that they thought were so important, like their building, right? Because ultimately, what Matthew learns as Jesus' disciples, what we all come to understand is that following Jesus is a continuing process of dying and rising. Dying to sin and rising in the righteousness of Christ. Dying to our ideas of our own self-importance and rising to the importance of serving other people. Dying to what we think of as success in the world and rising to see what God thinks of is real success. In order to follow my call by Jesus, I had to give up on a friendship that no longer work for me? What is it that Christ is asking you to give up? What is Christ calling you away from in order to follow him into God's kingdom? I hope this week you'll ponder that question. I know I will, as I continue to die and rise and listen to the call of Jesus to follow him. Amen. Let us rise as we sing our hymn of the day, O Christ, Your Heart Compassionate, number 722. Okay, it says, look at the screen for the creed. I forgot to put it up there. My apologies. But that's okay. These are simple words. You can put down your bulletins. You don't need them. Simple words. We're gonna practice it together before we sing it. Ready? I'm going to go through it with everybody, and then we're also going to do that. The words are, I believe, I do believe, truly I believe it. Say that. That was okay. Let's try one more time. I believe, I do believe, truly I believe it. I believe, I do believe, truly I believe. Okay. And then I believe in, and I'm going to forget the words. I believe in God, the Almighty Lord Creator.
I believe in God, the Almighty Lord Creator.
That, and then I believe, I do believe, truly I believe it. Again. And then I believe in Jesus, the Savior of the people. And I do believe in the power of the Spirit.
I do believe in the power of the Spirit.
That's the whole song right there. You can remember that, right? You don't need words for that. You can remember that. My goodness. I can remember that, and I can't remember anything. So here we go. All right, you're up. And Lindley's going to remind us of the lyrics as we go along. You all did wonderful without the lyrics. Great job.
Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. We pray, O God, for the church. Unite us with any on the margins, that the whole world recognizes that your mercy is greater than our human capacity to restrict it. God, in your mercy, we pray, O God, for creation. Tend forests and fields and safeguard all cattle, birds, and wild animals. Preserve lakes, rivers, and oceans, and send rains to water the earth. Revive lands recovering from natural disasters. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for the nations. Awaken in our leaders compassion for people who have too often felt forgotten or neglected, and inspire policy solutions that promote equity and inclusion. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for all who are in need. Accompany anyone enduring chronic illness, any who suffer in secret, and those grieving a loved one's death. Send healing for all who plead for relief from sickness or pain, especially Danny, Joanne, Carol and Rich, the Oliva family, Timothy, Ruth, Zoe, Heather, Helen, Rob, Alva, Sharon, Kirsten, Bruce, and Judy. We pray also for those who grieve, friends and families of the following: Frank, Mark, Gail, Toby, Florence, Aaron, Joe, Eugene, Bill, Doris, and Alice. And we remember our homebound, Betty Lee, and pray for all who serve: Joshua, Daniel, Gus, Isaac, and Graham. God, in your mercy, we pray, O God, for the eradication of racial hatred. On this week, when we commemorate the Emmanuel Nine, we implore you to cast out the demons of white supremacy that make us believe lies about ourselves and about our neighbors. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks, O God, for Barnabas and all the saints. Renew our faith that you can do what you have promised, and raise us with all our beloved dead to new life. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
Here, our own prayers may be offered aloud or in our hearts. Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer God's peace to our neighbors. Our worship continues with the offering. Let us rise as we sing our offering hymn.
Let us pray. Merciful God, as grains of wheat scattered upon the hills were gathered together to become one bread, so let your church be gathered together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. For yours is the glory through Jesus Christ, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. So with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at the end of all ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. It is our teaching and our tradition that we do not celebrate at the Lutheran table, we celebrate at the Lord's table. And the Lord invites everyone who's here and everybody watching online to share in this feast of God's mercy and God's grace. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
A couple of announcements of upcoming things. First, next Sunday, June 18th at 2 o'clock is Mark Bardo's homegoing service. So if you'd like to join with us for that, I hope you will. Come on June 18th at 2 o'clock. Softball starts June 19th at 6 o'clock at Centerpoint Field, which is on Clinton Street. So if you'd like to play, let me know or sign up, or if you'd just like to come watch us, which some people do. They just come and cheer us on as we do our best. So I would hope you come and be part of that as well. It's a fun night out. Also, June 25th to July 1st is our hosting week for Family Promise. Family Promise is a program for families experiencing homelessness. We host them in a church for a week where we feed them and give them a safe place to stay. That hosting week we do at St. Paul's Episcopal Church, which is the large Episcopal Church downtown next to the State Capitol building. We need people who will make a meal and bring it and serve it to the families. And we also need folks who are willing to spend the night in the church just to be a welcoming presence for the people. We hope that you will sign up. We need your help. This is a good way to follow Jesus. I hate to use my sermon, but I'm going to use it anyway. This is a good way to live your faith, to do something for somebody else who is experiencing a difficult time in their life. So it's a great program. Our church is one of the founding churches that brought Family Promise to Concord. So it's deep in our hearts. Paul's actually the president of the board. So it's deep in our DNA. So I'm begging for your help for that. Today is our last day of Sunday school for the year, so I just wanted to thank all of our teachers, Shannon, Caitlin, Andy, Heather, Catherine Taylor, Aspen. I wrote these down, and Charlie. I wrote it down, I couldn't read my own writing, that's terrible. Charlie, yes, so I hope you will join me in giving all of them a round of applause. We had a very good Sunday school year. I was very happy with it. Thanks to the teachers who put all the time and effort into it. And thanks to all the parents who brought their kids and had them be part of our congregation. And hope that they learned how much God loves and cares for them in his grace that abides in their lives this year. Also like to thank our choir. This is the last day of choir for the summer. So if we could give a round of applause for our choir. They're not quite. They will be singing at Mark's funeral and on August 6th at the anniversary of my ordination. But thanks especially to Janet and Lindley for all of their hard work. This year will be a lot of education. And for those who are interested, choir practice will start again in September, Thursday nights at 6:30. So if you want to jump in and join the choir at that time, that's a good time to jump back in and join the choir. We will be having a barbecue today, so please join us right through these doors. Please go that way and have a hot dog and hamburger and Christian fellowship with one another at the end of our service today. And now, Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Let us rise as we sing our sending song, I'm So Glad Jesus Lifted Me, number 860.